It is incredibly frustrating to not have a Google Home, a Google Nest product, or a Chromecast or other Google-based product not working in your smart home. And today I'm going to tell you why that is happening and how to fix it. Hello, automators. Thanks for tuning in again. I'm Brian from Automate Your Life, and today I'm going to literally take the frustration out of automation and definitely out of your Google Home products, all these different errors and different situations that we can have. Now, today we're going to go from very simple issues, very simple fixes, all the way to the most complex, but that complex one is probably what's happening to you. It's what I've kind of learned over time. That complex issue is likely what is causing you the most problems in your smart home with your Google products. And so you're going to want to stay to the end of this one. Speaking of simple solutions, one of the easiest things to fix is actually your permissions. Now, this I understand. I understand why people go and they try and pull back the permissions that they have given under their Google account to Google in order to pull back a little bit of that privacy and control of their data and information. I get it. But the fact of the matter is, if you want these products to work correctly right now, Google requires all of these permissions to be turned on. A very common error, and something I produced a video about a little while ago, actually, I think last year, was called the I need more information error. And that specific error has plagued a lot of people for a lot of times. One of the ways to fix this is to turn on all of those permissions. And that works for about 90% of people who have a Google Home product or a Google Home Mini, whatever device you have that requires those permissions. To manage the privacy settings, go to account.google.com and then head into privacy and personalization. Then you will know notice three different activity controls on that page. Now you will see web and app activity, location history, and YouTube history, and you want them all to say on for everything to work correctly on your Google Home. Now you'll notice the little slider on the right, those all have to be turned on, and you can see the check marks on my screen that I have. Below that, you might be having trouble with calling people, so there is the people and sharing section that you will find here, and you want both of those settings turned on. You can click into each one and make sure they're turned on. And that will grant your Google Home and other products permission to call people or message people. Back on that main page, you will also find the activity for your Google Assistant. Now you can manage to delete recordings and things here, but here's another view into all the different permissions that your assistant is using. And if all of those are not on, you need them to be on in order to get all capabilities from your Google Home. The other subset of people is actually based on the type of Google account you have. And this is something I did not understand at the time of making that previous video and why this is a bit of an upgrade is it's that type of account. So students a lot run into this, and people who've gotten their Google account from a business, those business relationships or those student relationships with the Google Assistant and that overall Google account don't allow you to actually give all the permissions that Google needs. Even if you're sitting there toggling those switches on your account page, that is not happening correctly. So what I actually tell people is go get a new Google account, just sign up for a new one and reset up your Google Home products under that account. Get out of that student account, get out of that business account, and you will find that suddenly your permissions work right and you're not getting those errors any longer. Now that you have the basics of your Google account all squared away, we can talk about a little bit more of a technical issue. And what this boils down to is two languages, or having two languages selected inside the Google Home or the Google Assistant application. Having two languages selected can slow down the response and even cause some very strange issues when you're talking about any of your Google Home or a Google Assistant enabled device. And I had something really strange the other day where my Google Nest Mini was only speaking to me in German despite me asking questions in English. And even though I was speaking English and it understood a couple of the commands, it spoke German back to me just because I had that set as a second language. So go remove that. If you have two sitting there and you don't need it, go remove that. One thing that I've been honing in on more and more is how the actual placement of your Google Home speaker can really affect its reliability in terms of its responses out of the Google Assistant. And there's a number of ways. Now, if you stick your Google Nest Mini or Home Mini, definitely those products with the open mic ports, if you stick those in a dusty or a humid environment and things start to get in there, guys. That's basically the answer here. You can actually fill those microphone ports and then it will not be able to hear you very well. You'll be sitting there yelling at it. But in a lot of cases, the yelling actually comes from a different component of your placement. And what I find with a lot of people is they stick their Google Home product really close next to the wall, and that's because there's a cable, and that wall is shiny reflective, and it will reverberate sound back at the microphones. And this can be one of the most critical things for any audio processing. If you've ever done audio processing and then you have echo in some of your recordings, you will know how much impact that can have on your recording, how bad it can sound, and how difficult it can actually be to pick out what you're saying. So you don't want an echo next to that speaker or affecting that speaker. And so when people stick these under cabinets or in kind of those reflective spaces where there's a lot of opportunity for sound to bounce off of surfaces and towards the microphones on these devices, this can become a real source of inaccuracy and people can get very frustrated with their devices. So actually think about your placement and maybe just try moving just for a few minutes based on you having some issues with a Google Home product. Try moving it into the center of a room, creating a little softness in that room in terms of the surfaces. So this is a hard surface. This is reflective. It will reverberate sound off of it. It will create echoes. And so this could be part of your issues. Another great source of issue for people in terms of their Google Home product hearing them is ambient noise. Now, we always see this with the speakers. When the speakers are playing and it's very loud, your Google Home products can't hear you very well. The same is true with general ambient noise, and especially if that ambient noise is moving a little bit. So when it's a very constant thing, it's a little easier for them to pick out, okay, that person used the wake word and this is what they're saying over and above that very consistent ambient noise. But if it's not consistent and it's moving around a little bit, that can be very hard for them to pick out. And so this can actually impact you in your smart home, again, with your Google Home products. One other thing you should do within the Google Home application is retrain that voice match every so often. Now, why I say that is because Google actually updates how they handle that voice match or that voice recognition every so often, and they have at points and times required us to update our voice match. But what I'm telling you is that every so often, just go in there. If you're sitting in the application, you're doing some work in your settings, retrain your voice match. Make sure you do it in a quiet environment with no ambient noise. Now, before I get into what is definitely the most complicated solution for fixing your Google Home products in your smart home, go ahead, guys. I know you're probably having other types of issues. Leave those down below. I respond to every comment I can. And then I also include lots of questions that we get from subscribers in our new monthly series on Automators Answered. Now, the most complex issue is likely your own issue in a lot of ways. So you need to look within. And I'm not some self-help guru who's going to try and charge you for my book at the end of this. Although I do have a book about smart speakers, so you can go buy that. But what I mean by looking within is your own network or the networks around you are your most likely issue with these products. So what do I mean by that? Google Home products connect either through a 2.4 gigahertz or a 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi network. And when they do that, so do a lot of other devices. Both of those frequencies are used by a lot of other devices, a lot of other network types, and they're just generally open network frequencies. So there can be a lot of interference on those, and especially coming from your neighbors. So one of the sources of the worst interference you can have is a strong Wi-Fi network or another strong wireless network near your Google Home product or your Wi-Fi router or access points. If you have a mesh system, you could really have a lot of interference there causing you issues. Now, there's a really easy way to diagnose this. You're going to need an Android device for this specific application, but there's a few applications out there. This is called Wi-Fi Man, and what's really great about Wi-Fi Man is the fact that you can actually walk throughout your home and see on the channels page of that application what Wi-Fi signals and how strong they are in each area. So you'll see your own, and if it's at the top of that list, then you have pretty good coverage in that space, and there's general numbers that you're wanting for the strength of your Wi-Fi network in order to connect to your Google Home product. So number one, if you're not seeing a strong Wi-Fi signal, that's a pretty good indicator for you that you're going to have connectivity issues, and you'll probably see that as whenever you go up to your Google Home product or you ask it something, that it responds with, "I'm not connected to the internet right now, please check." The other thing is you will see your neighbor's network or all your neighbor's networks and how strong they are in comparison to your own and how much they could be interfering. And you can walk right up to your device, be very close to your device, and see what the different networks are like right there. If you're seeing a problem, move it, get out of the way, see if this changes your reliability. It's a really simple way of self-diagnosing. Now, as you look within that Wi-Fi application there, you'll notice that there are channels, and there are different channels that you can set on most routers or mesh Wi-Fi systems. You can actually move your channel as well to get away from really strong networks. So you might find actually moving that channel as something you have to do within your router. You might have to call your ISP if you're using theirs. Then once you do that, you may find that your whole smart home behaves a lot better, and especially your Google Home products. The other side of connectivity with your Google Home products is more complex to diagnose, but you can see this again, if you're kind of feeling good about those things we just talked about, then you might actually be running into a limitation of your router or your mesh Wi-Fi system. And let me tell you guys, you can go out today and you can buy a new mesh Wi-Fi system that still is not very good and will not connect to a lot of Wi-Fi devices in your smart home. So you can actually still run into this, even if your stuff is brand new. And I think what you have to understand is that there are specific routers and specific mesh Wi-Fi systems that are being developed for smart home people. And when I went through a couple of different router upgrades, I really learned this, especially in my last iteration here. So what I'm going to tell you is that, you know, initially I had a router that didn't even have a 5 gigahertz transceiver on it. That can be a really great way to balance things. So you can move some of your devices to 5 gigahertz, and that might get you out of some of this interference. That's a really great way to balance things on your network overall as well. So you can actually move Google Home products over to 5 gigahertz. That might help you there. But my initial router that I started my smart home with did not even have that 5 gigahertz band. So you might need to just upgrade there. Now, the router I went to after that, highly recommended. Lots of people loved it. It was working very well in general, but once I kind of went from that old router with about 20 to 30 devices up to 60 to 70 Wi-Fi connected devices, this router started running into issues. And it can come from a couple of different sources, and I don't want to get really into the nitty-gritty, but you could just basically have too many connections for that device to manage in a lot of different ways. And when it kind of hits its limit, it will start dropping connections, and it will seem random to you. You won't understand why. And that's maybe the easiest symptom to kind of diagnose. You might have one that happens more than others, but it can be random, and you'll find things not working. You might ask for a light bulb to go on and it won't work. That kind of thing can be related to this issue. So you can kind of be hitting your device limits. Now, when I went to Nest Wi-Fi, and this is kind of the point, If you read the technical specifications of Nest Wi-Fi, they say each the router and each access point, each of those can connect to up to 100 Wi-Fi devices at the same time. They can maintain those connections. Now they say up to 100, so I don't know what the upper limit is, but I can tell you I'm moving well beyond my 60 to 70. I'm holding very well at around 70 right now. I'm not dropping devices all the time, and that's the important component. So I have a strong Wi-Fi signal strength because I have a mesh system throughout my home, and because I have the router and an access point, I have that connectivity capacity of up to 200 devices, and it is maintaining that connection, and it has created way more reliability than that last router that I had. So that's what I'd be looking at. And you guys, you can go and you can buy these prosumer level devices. And if you have the money to do that, go for it. There's some great options out there. The more you can keep wired, the better in your smart home as well. That's always going to be the case, I think. But in general here, I think the Nest Wi-Fi is kind of that right level for most people who are just, they don't have hundreds and hundreds of devices. They're not trying to stream across 8 different devices at the same time. I think the Nest Wi-Fi is kind of that right level. There's other great options out there from Amazon if you're looking at that, but we're talking about a Google connected smart home. So Nest Wi-Fi also works within the Google Home application. It's completely integrated in there at this point. I do have a review of the Nest Wi-Fi where I talk about my entire experience going through that, how that changed my smart home, how that changed everything. That is on screen. Otherwise, now that you have things fixed, you might want the Google Home newest updates, newest features, and newest capabilities from that whole thing. We do that smart home news constantly on the channel here, so check out the latest with the links on screen. Otherwise, guys, thanks for watching, and of course, don't hate, automate.